Welcome to this Huddersfield Local History Society virtual talk. This welcome is first of all for our members, but also for those of you who found us by searching the internet. We hope that you enjoy this talk and that you'll come and join us again. My name is Cyril Pearce, and as chair of Huddersfield Local History Society, I am privileged to be able to say something about tonight's speaker and to introduce him. The Society is fortunate in having amongst its members a good, rich source of active local history researchers, some of whom are acknowledged far beyond Huddersfield as specialists in their own field. And tonight's speaker, Alan Brooke, is just one of these experts. Together with the late Lesley Kipling some years ago, he researched and wrote Liberty or Death, an account of struggles of radicals and Luddites and Republicans in the West Riding of Yorkshire and further afield in the late 18th and early 19th century. That book is now widely regarded as a classic. Last year, 2019, was the bicentenary of Peterloo. Those appalling events in Manchester when an armed contingent of the militia attacked a peaceful crowd of people agitating in a peaceful way for parliamentary reform and killed so many of them. Alan has chosen that as his topic for tonight, but not so much the Peterloo events themselves as the impact Peterloo had here in the West Riding of Yorkshire and further afield, and what happened after 1819.
Hello, I'm afraid that this talk is going to be a pure substitute for what was planned for this year. Amongst the schedule of lectures was to be something on the bicentenary of the 1820 uprising, and the late and sadly missed Malcolm Chase was to deliver this. I must take this opportunity of expressing my own tribute to Malcolm for the help he's given me over various issues. As far as thanks go, I ought to mention also Jeanette Martin, who sent me the invaluable link for the Manchester Observer, which has been quite important in compiling this talk. So what's the subject? Well, I'd like to talk about not about the 1820 uprising and not about Peterloo, but about the period in between, referring particularly to West Yorkshire. I won't focus on Huddersfield because this has been covered in Liberty or Death. So if you want to know that story in more detail, please get a copy of the book. The South Yorkshire situation has also been covered by other writers, including Dr. John Baxter, who's been very helpful in lending me a copy of his forthcoming Borthwick paper on this very period. But fortunately, I found that we don't overlap too much and there's emphasis is quite different. So I'm going to speak about West Yorkshire, that is mainly the mining and textile areas covering Leeds, Bradford, Huddersfield, Dewsbury, Halifax, etc., with only scant references to other parts of the West Riding. So the theme I want to explore is what happened after Peterloo, how the tensions between the different classes in Yorkshire and the different political interests were exacerbated by that, and how this developed and how the process eventually led to the 1820 uprising. So I won't go into the details of Peterloo itself. There's lots of good books on that, including Robert Poole's new one that came out to mark the bicentenary of that event. So if you want to understand the events of the 16th of August itself in Manchester, please refer to those. What's interesting for us is how did the news come from Manchester to Yorkshire? And it seems that there were at least two people from Huddersfield present at the event. And so there may possibly have been others there who would, of course, have wanted to get the news back home as quickly as possible. One person we know that was there from Huddersfield was Benjamin Haig Allen, the magistrate, who dashed off a quick note to the Home Office recounting the events that had taken place. But amongst the ordinary people, we have the name in the list of injured of Rebecca Johnson from Longride Bridge. But we don't hear anything else about her. We don't know why she was there or what her interest was. But another person from West Yorkshire we do know something about, and that was John Smithson from Leeds, who was an active radical. He was there because he clearly supported the mass meeting, and he had a long history and quite a long future of involvement in radical politics. He played a leading role over the next few months organising and speaking at meetings, and he was known to Richard Carlyle, the editor of the periodical called The Republican. So it's quite possible that even at this early stage when he was at Manchester, he was already a Republican and one of the militant supporters of the radical reform movement. In fact, Carlyle later acknowledged in his journal, talking of Smithson, he said, "I've conversed with you in London. I've conversed with you in Manchester. You were the one to feel the sabres of the Manchester Yeomanry. You had more of my company in Manchester than any other man." So it seems he was quite close to Carlyle. So we do have some idea of Smithson's political ideas. He's not to be confused with John Smithson, the Liberal Council from Almondbury, by the way. So we know there was at least two people from West Yorkshire there at Peterloo who experienced the events, and quite possibly there were others. But how the news got back to Yorkshire, we don't know. Anne Lister records in her diaries that it came by stagecoach to Halifax, but that might only mean that's how, the way that she and her circle of friends found out. But there's a little report in the Leeds Mercury that does describe the events or the situation in Leeds after the Manchester massacre. And it said, "In Leeds, as in many other places, the intelligence of the sanguinary scenes transacted in Manchester on Monday produced a deep sensation. Large bodies of people, drawn principally by a wish to obtain correct information, lined the streets till nearly midnight on Tuesday. The general opinion, even among men uninfluenced in any particular degree by party feelings, was that a reprehensible precipitancy and rigour had been shown by the constituted authorities in Manchester." I did add that some had regretted that Henry Hunt, the radical leader, hadn't been amongst the killed. And it also referred to the march and countermarch of troops in around Yorkshire. But it did say that so far there had been no difference between soldiers and inhabitants. So at this stage, the Leeds Mercury at least was quite optimistic about the situation and that it wouldn't escalate. But reports kept coming in of shadowy figures appearing in Yorkshire, spreading news of Manchester, and as the authorities saw it, inciting people to insurrection. The first figure we hear is of a man on a horse arriving to address a crowd on a Skirkote Moor near Halifax on the Wednesday. Do you remember that the massacre had been on the Monday? The Skirkote Moor meeting was dispersed by the local magistrate, Thomas Horton, who rode out himself on his horse. And he says at his approach, the man, the stranger on a horse, disappeared. And the meeting was only a few hundred people anyway. And on Hunslet Moor, Wednesday evening, there was another abortive meeting. Again, we've only got shadowy reports of that. And the day after, the Thursday, there was another meeting on Hunslet Moor. But at this one, though a meeting took place, the expected speakers from Manchester didn't turn up with the news and the report of of the events that had taken place. A bit nearer home on Thursday, there was also a mass meeting on Almondbury Bank, when again it was said that some outsiders from Lancashire had come trying to incite the people to rebellion. telling them at the next meeting they must come prepared. And at this, some people shouted from the crowd, "What with firearms?" And so the authorities were getting quite alarmed at these reports which were trickling in. And there was supposed to be a meeting at Fixby on the Friday. But the authorities, according to one report, sent people round to the villages warning people off attending, and only a few turned up. But there is a little interpolation on a poster which was sent to the Home Office by the magistrates, which claims that the Huddersfield yeomen also showed up, and those that had the temerity to turn out were frightened off by the yeomanry. So there were hints already that tensions were growing. These were fuelled by all sorts of rumours, of course, and one was that there was drilling of men taking place on Crossland Moor, very near to the place where Horsfall had been shot in 1812. But this was later strongly denied by a correspondent from Huddersfield who wrote to the Leeds Mercury saying that this was the Leeds Independent just trying to stir up alarm and to discredit the Huddersfield magistrates for their inactivity. So in the first week, there was some activity taking place amongst the radicals trying to organise themselves and respond to events in Manchester. But by the Friday at least, there'd been no real event taking place to cause any concern to the authorities. So if we look at some of the people involved on both sides, it'll give us an idea of the growing tensions which were taking place. For example, we've heard of John Smithson already, and at the meeting on the following Tuesday on Hunslet Moor, he said that he was too ill to give an account of events in Manchester, but would hope to do it in the future. And the first report we hear of him doing this was at a meeting on the 22nd of September at Driglington, where he said he gave in minute detail his escape from the most imminent danger on the 16th of August at Manchester. So perhaps at the first meeting he was feeling a bit traumatised and couldn't recount his experiences, but did so later on. He also was quite prominent in promoting a union of female reformers, which was organised in Leeds. There was also another one in the Huddersfield area, and these had been begun in the weeks before Peterloo. But often they were always seen, quote, to support their husbands. And their main activity was making caps of liver to present to the speakers at meetings. But we will come across one of these female reformers a little later on. The other characters involved on the radical side who were leading actors was, for example, T.S. Bristow, who was a Shipley schoolmaster, and a correspondent to the Independent claimed that he'd been dismissed for allowing reform meetings to take place in the schoolroom. And another schoolmaster who was even more prominent in the modern movement was John Brayshaw of Eden, and he was to play a very active role in the year, in the weeks and months leading up to the 1820 insurrection. Another interesting character who spoke at one of the early Hunslet Moor meetings was John Winter, because he was inspired by Robert Owen's plans to settle communities on the land. And he gave a very class-aware speech, quote, in which he charged the opulent manufacturers, merchants and extensive tradesmen with removing the burdens of the state from off their own shoulders upon those who earned their bread by the sweat of their brow, and then refusing to assist the labouring poor in the attainment of their rights and liberties from the iron hand of tyranny. So he was definitely on the quite militant wing of the radical movement. But as I say, at this early stage, to find it linked with the Owenite ideas is quite interesting. Now, one of the most prominent active radicals in there was John Mann. He'd been implicated in the 1817 uprising and almost became a victim of that. He was a newspaper and bookseller of Brigate, and he had been a cropper previously and came under the authorities' radar as a suspected Luddite. And interestingly, another bookseller from Brigate was John Butterwick, who was described as an old bookseller. And I presume this means he sold old books, not that he was actually old. But he may well have been, because in one of his speeches he said he'd been a radical for 25 years and been spurred back into action again by the events at Peterloo. Another prominent radical in there, it was James Willen, who was a printer and was also a Quaker, lived at Northgate in Dewsbury. Again, he'd almost been entrapped in the 1817 conspiracy to foment an insurrection in the West Riding. His sidekick was John Dickinson, who was a draper, also from Northgate in Dewsbury. And these two men were very prominent in there, and particularly in Huddersfield. Huddersfield didn't seem to have thrown up any leaders of countywide importance at this time. And apart from these local men who were involved, there were other speakers who were described as itinerant orators, which is used with a more or less the same contempt today as the term outside agitators or whatever. And these were people from, many of them from Manchester, including John Chapman, who was the editor of the Manchester Observer, or the owner, I can't quite remember. John Knight, who again was a veteran, a radical from Saddleworth. And the best known of all, perhaps, was Joseph Mitchell. Now, he had actually been implicated in the 1817 uprising and had been jailed for it. He'd been arrested in the Huddersfield vicinity and was a close collaborator with the government provocateur Oliver. And this episode came back to haunt him several times during his political career. There was also, for a period, active in our area, Thomas Wooler, who was the editor of the radical journal, The Black Dwarf. And another Manchester man who I should mention is John Saxton, who again was on the platform at the time of the Manchester massacre. And he, on occasions at meeting, described firsthand the events which he'd witnessed from the Ustins. So, just to mention again the female reformers, the one whose name in Huddersfield was someone called Alice Tittenser, whose husband was an active radical. And at Leeds, we hear of Isabella Blackburn. And at one of the meetings on Hunslet Moor, it says, quote, "In feeble voice and diffident manner," unquote, "she presented a cap of liberty to the chairman, and who read an address of the female reformers of Leeds to their fellow townswomen." And this is interesting because it wasn't as laced with jargon as a lot of the declarations, and you can almost hear the women speaking. So I'll quote this in a few sentences. "Our husbands cannot find employment, or being employed, the wages they receive are scarcely sufficient to procure food to prolong a miserable existence. Our dwellings once contained some decent furniture, the pride and glory of our happier days, but it is gone to satisfy the tax gatherer and the landlord. Are we and our children then to be starved out of existence? Who knows but another Esther may arise? Come forward and join with us." Esther's a reference, of course, to the Esther in the Bible. So these reflect very much the cross-section of the radical leadership. If you noted, most of them weren't manual labourers. They're mostly people of independent means, schoolmasters, publishers, etc., booksellers, and journalists, people who really had some freedom of movement and weren't as beholden to the employers as a manual worker would be, apart from, of course, also having a much higher standard of education. So who were on the other side? I've also already mentioned B.H. Allen, and he, along with the other Huddersfield magistrates, John Haig and John Horsfall, were active in trying to repress any radical dissent. And the Huddersfield, as I've mentioned, was one of the few places involved in the 1817 uprising, so they could claim some experience. And one of their first actions was to announce the enrolment of special constables. And the correspondent from Huddersfield wrote to the Mercury, "The people are all in great anxiety. The magistrates assembled and on alert." Another magistrate who was very much on alert was Thomas Horton, the magistrate from Halifax. And he wrote to the Home Office saying, "The law orders in this part of the country are very much irritated by the conduct of the civil and military authorities in Manchester." And he thought that most espoused the cause of the revolutionists, for so they are. And he was very much an alarmist, and he pestered the Home Office to send troops to Halifax. But General John, being the Northern commander, was very reluctant to comply, since he was overstretched already. And he also, you suspect, he thought Horton was being alarmist and was going over his head asking the Home Office for troops. Horton's plan to raise its own yeoman in Halifax came unstuck. He managed to raise about 300 special constables, but his plan for a troop of yeomanry cavalry was stymied by the townspeople, who refused to take part in his plan. But in response, he drew up a loyal address to send to the government, which he asked the prominent members of the community in Halifax to sign. And in this, he described the radical reformers as revolutionists, anarchists and plunderers. So some very contemporary terminology there. He also, on November the 8th, when there was an incident when men returning from the meeting, and a meeting at Almondbury Bank in Huddersfield, marched into Halifax firing pistols, and he saw that this was the cause for great alarm, and he pressed General Byng for the establishment at least of a temporary barracks for four companies of the 6th Regiment in Halifax. And in fact, Anne Lister in her diaries mentions this, and she went to see the barracks, which were being made out of a warehouse. And it was expected that four companies of the 6th Foot were going to be stationed there. So Thomas Horton was very active against the radical reformers, and he was one of those who saw it as a portent of revolution. Other local officials in Yorkshire included George Banks, who was one-time mayor and cloth merchant of Leeds, and he's believed that the reformers were using the events in Manchester, quote, as a means of drawing their infatuated followers into acts of violence. And he saw that the marches, accompanied by drums and bands of music, as excitements that form a new and unfavourable feature in their proceedings, thinking it was some sort of paramilitary display. And he also requested General Byng to send a troop of dragoons to reinforce those already in Leeds. And he was also active in trying to get James Mann prosecuted for selling radical literature. Another Leeds personality was very much involved in surveillance of the radicals was the postmaster, Mark Temple. And he, in fact, was involved in opening letters and spying on the correspondence between radicals. And he said he was focusing on those towns where, quote, the lower orders appear to be disaffected. And another Leeds character was the solicitor, Thomas Foden, and he wrote of the considerable alarm entertained in this district from the obvious tendency to insurrection indicated by the proceedings of the disaffected. So it sounds as quite pompous. He also wanted the Home Office to prosecute the Leeds Mercury for seditious libel for criticisms that had occurred in that quite respectable middle-class paper criticising the Manchester Yeomanry magistrates. Another very active correspondent was John Todd Naylor, merchant of Wood Street, Wakefield. He kept an eye on radical meetings in that town and wrote frequently to the Home Office. And he, in one of his reports, he said quite interestingly, "There is some system of meeting in classes that still continues in the different towns and villages communicating with each other. I am much afraid as the winter approaches, many nightly depredations will be committed and attacks on machinery." So why should I add that? I don't know, since there'd been no hints really that machinery was a target by the radicals at this time. Another of the hawks, if you like, was the Lord Ribblesdale, who was on the fringe of this area, really, seeing his territory was Skipton. But there was a public meeting addressed by the radical schoolmaster Brayshaw, and Lord Ribblesdale had a troop of the Craven Yeomanry Cavalry on standby in the castle, expecting a riot, but none took place. So those are some of the main characters and some of the attitudes which they reflected. And over the following months, there was meetings all over West Yorkshire, as well as Yorkshire as a whole. So just to list them briefly, Leeds, Halifax, Almondbury Bank, which was the main meeting place for Huddersfield radicals, Shipley, Sheffield, Wakefield, York, Armley, Bridlington, Bramley, Idle, Rothwell, Hull, Dewsbury, Skipton, Keighley, Bradford, Barnsley, Otley, Knaresborough, and at Harewood there was an interesting, it wasn't really a meeting, but it was a demonstration when the radicals walked into the church one Sunday en masse bearing radical symbols, which is wearing white hats, to protest about their concerns about the injustice over Peterloo. I won't detail these meetings. The one on several on Almondbury Bank have been described in Liberty or Death, and the sort of speeches and demands and resolutions, the slogans and the banners are described there. And the newspaper reports, which can be followed up now quite easily online, often vividly describe the events at some of the mass meetings which took place at this time. I mean, and of course, we have the unique advantage in our area of having an actual banner from that period, which is the so-called Skelmanthorpe flag. And this was just one of hundreds which were made at that time, reflecting people's concerns and indignation and anger at what had happened at Peterloo and calling for demands for parliamentary reform. So these meetings were taking place, as I say, all over Yorkshire in the months immediately after Peterloo. And the tension at some of these meetings often showed itself. For example, on the 23rd September at on Hunslet Moor, there was another mass meeting there, when there was sudden panic developed in the crowd and cries of the cavalry are coming. And some people started to run away. But the speakers on the platform rallied the crowd by calling for a great cheer. And this was occasioned, according to the Leeds Intelligencer, by a coal wagon going down the railroad to Middleton Colliery, which passed over Hunslet Moor and its way down to the Stays on the River Ayr. And in the beginning of October, there was again a massive meeting at Scarecrow Moor at Halifax. The numbers given in the newspapers are often pretty unreliable, but when they say tens of thousands, you know it was pretty big. And so this was a pretty big meeting. And again, there was an alarm that the soldiers were coming. And in fact, it was sparked off, ironically, by one of the speakers saying, if you hear any alarms of cavalry, don't be afraid. And in fact, by process of Chinese whispers, they spread to the crowd to say, alarm, cavalry was coming. And one of the newspaper reports described the whole common was covered with a scattered multitude who ran pell-mell, and then it left the hats and the shawls and the shoes and handkerchiefs as they all ran away to the walls on the edge of the moor. But they were rallied by the speaker. But twice again, during that same meeting, these sort of alarms took place. And the third one, according to a newspaper report, it said it caused extreme vexation to the speakers, which is not surprising, seeing as it was hard enough speaking to a crowd of thousands without microphones, and on this particular day when it was also pouring with rain. And also, the same meeting, part of the hustings collapsed. So it was quite a chaotic meeting on that occasion. But this phenomenon wasn't something that just happened after Peterloo. In fact, at the meeting at Blackburn on 5th of July, there'd been a panic which had seized the crowd there. So that sort of tension was already existing, but it was certainly exacerbated by what had happened at Peterloo, where the military had actually attacked the crowd. So there was growing tension between the authorities and the radicals, but amongst the radicals and also amongst some of the upper classes, there was an attempt to build some sort of alliance to get justice for the sufferers of Peterloo. And in fact, John Mann had claimed at one meeting that Lord Fitzwilliam had prevented the yeomanry turning out at Sheffield there to attack a meeting. But this story was dismissed by the Leeds Mercury as an attempt, in fact, to discredit Lord Fitzwilliam. But Fitzwilliam was one of the liberal Whig, well, aristocrats, really, and he was the Lord Lieutenant of Yorkshire. And as such, he was present at a massive meeting in York Castle on the Thursday, the 14th of October, which had been called by the burghers of York and had many respectable people there, including, as I say, Fitzwilliam and also the Duke of Norfolk and also Stuart Wortley of Wortley Hall, Walter Fawkes of Farnley Hall, and Lord Milton, who was a scion of the Fitzwilliam family. But also at this meeting, several thousands of working class radicals from West Yorkshire marched overnight to attend it. And there were contingents there from Leeds and Dewsbury and all the surrounding villages. And they met up with the other radicals at Micklegate Bar and then joined the large Whig meeting. But again, some of the tensions that were developing amongst the radicals and between the radicals and the more respectable Whig elements came out at this meeting. It hinged around the character of Joseph Mitchell, who, as I've mentioned, was involved in the 1817 uprising and as such was very much under a cloud and was the target of the Leeds Mercury, who claimed still that he was a provocateur and government spy. So that meeting at York also ended in a bit of chaos when Mitchell tried to speak but was shouted down by some of the more so-called moderate Whig elements, but also by his fellow radicals who were increasingly afraid of being associated with him. So as a result of that, the main thing that happened, which was to have repercussions, was Lord Fitzwilliam, because of his association with such disreputable radical characters, was dismissed from his post as Lord Lieutenant, which meant that the more hawkish Henry Lascelles, the Tory, was now the Lieutenant of the county, in some extent in control of its civil and military authorities. Now, the thing that was worrying the authorities about all these meetings was that they were all gearing up to eventually to some sort of insurrectionary climax. And the fact that a number of radical meetings were called simultaneously on the same day led to quite a lot of concern amongst both the military and the civil authorities that this was going to be the prelude to some kind of uprising. So the response to the growing agitation was not to follow Lord Fitzwilliam's path of seeking some sort of justice for the sufferers of Peterloo and also perhaps some limited parliamentary reform. But the response by the government, with the Lord Lascelles as one of its cheerleaders, to introduce repressive legislation. And these came in the form of the six acts which repress meetings and freedom of speech, freedom of the press, etc., as well as perhaps more understandable things as the arming and drilling. When it was being discussed in Parliament, Lord Lascelles said this of the people of the county. He believed that thousands who originally listened through curiosity to the novel doctrine of these demagogues soon became ready to assist them in the execution of their wicked designs. He knew his own county, and though he could say the entire mass of people was not ripe for disaffection, yet he believed it would not be denied that a great mass was ripe. He was convinced that the present disaffected spirit could not be allayed whilst persons were allowed to travel through the country to address meetings. And he also commented about the female reformers bringing up their children with no respect for the Christian religion and, quote, and of all established order. So there was some support in Parliament from Lascelles for this repressive legislation. And it soon, even as it was going through Parliament, it already was undermining the radical movement, because people were increasingly afraid to go to meetings because, as I said, there's already a tension there and a fear that the authorities would carry out an armed attack on the meetings. And now that they were backed by, or was soon to be backed by, this repressive legislation, meant that people were more and more cautious about sticking their neck out. So at a meeting on the 9th of December at Huddersfield Moor, again, there was a dispute between the radicals themselves about what course of action they should take. Some wanted to just petition the Prince Regent against the laws that were going through Parliament, affecting the rights of the people, quote-unquote. But there was only about 2,000 at this meeting, and most of them who were there had no time for any more lukewarm measures like that. And when Joseph Brayshaw called for a resistance to the laws and the right to use arms in self-defence, most of the people in the crowd responded positively to that. Again, one of those against the physical force doctrine was William Willan of Dewsbury. And he called again for reason and argument instead of arming themselves. And the best way was to disarm their enemies, and that use of arms will assuredly lead to the destruction of yourselves and the manacling of your country in the iron fetters of despotism. So this indicates quite clearly how the radical movement was becoming polarised between those who wanted to follow a peaceable course of action, which in effect now meetings were more or less banned and the press was more or less banned, meant being able to do very little. And those radicals who thought that now the legitimate political ways were close to them, that armed insurrection was the only viable alternative. The Mercury later commented that the support by Lascelles and also by Stuart Wortley for more strict legislation wasn't really justified by events. There was a claim that a meeting at Barnsley on the 13th of December was going to signal the start of an insurrection. But only a few, according to the press, mostly boys, turned up to be addressed by an incendiary, quote, a delegate from God knows where. And there was no real threat to society from them. And the troop of dragoons that were sent from Sheffield returned back to base without having to see any action. So the situation then by the end of the year was getting more and more dire for the ordinary working class people, while at the same time the means they had of expressing their political ideas were being repressed. And the situation that winter really was pretty bad. It was one of the harshest winters for some time, and also there was widespread unemployment amongst many working class people. There was soup kitchens were being set up throughout the area and funds raised for the relief of the poor. So as the political options were closed down, the economic plight of a lot of workers was increasing. There's an interesting quote from Rowbottom's diary. He's an Oldham working class diarist of that time, which is quite, though not in our area, it sums up the situation pretty well. He says, the year 1820 began on Saturday, which was a cold winter's day. The earth covered with snow and a very severe frost. Trade being so bad that poor people in general felt very little of Christmas cheer, and the old English ancient hospitality was nearly lost in some of the first families in this neighbourhood, and people's minds being soured by oppression made the lower class very uneasy. So how did this uneasiness amongst the lower classes manifest itself? And how did this feed into the tension which was developing between the classes and the apprehension amongst those in authority that there was something was in the offing? Two of the main groups of workers in West Yorkshire at this time were, of course, the textile workers and the miners, and both of these were involved in disputes during this period. In fact, even before the Peterloo Massacre, there'd been a dispute brewing, particularly in the Dewsbury area, amongst the weavers, the blanket weavers, many of them employed by Messrs. Halliley, Son and Brooke, were described by the Leeds Mercury as the largest blanket manufacturers in England, and that they'd resolved to shut down the mill in July in a bid to lock out the workers who were demanding improved wages. There's also disputes amongst textile workers at Pudsey in July. And despite the attempt to lock out the workers by Halliley and Son, the blanket weavers dispute, well, both weavers and spinners dispute, escalated and affected people in Hickmondwike, Dewsbury and other parts of the blanket manufacturing districts, leading to what began partly as a lockout into a widespread strike. But the initial reports were very mixed about who was on strike and who was being locked out and what the actual demands were. But it's quite clear that many of them were organised at this time into what was sometimes called the Clothiers' Union and sometimes the Weavers' Union, which you have to remember, because of the Combination Acts, was an illegal organisation. And there, in August, a few days after Peterloo, it was reported in the Mercury that around 2,000 mourners attended the funeral of a man called John Gill, who was a member of the Dewsbury Clothers Union. And despite some rumours that trade was improving over the following month, it certainly wasn't. Adelister, again in a diary, of the 24th of September, said, reported a great many people out of work, a very creditable-looking woman who had been obliged to sell all their furniture and all the clothes but what she had on, applied to me, and afterwards two weavers. And the strike, by this time, according to a letter from a weaver to Leeds Mercury, included people in Dewsbury, Hickman, Dwight, Batley and Stanningley. In Stanningley, the situation was that the main manufacturer there, called Varley's, had asked the overseer of the poor to provide him with some unemployed who were working on the roads for outdoor relief to come and work in his mill in order to break the strike. And a result of this, there was an attack on them by the workers who threw mud and stones at them. And the situation, the authorities thought, was getting quite out of hand. And several of the workers were arrested. Those, we're talking now about the Pudsey and Stanningley area. So across our area, from Dewsbury, Hickman, Dwight to Pudsey and Stanningley, there was a number of disputes going on, which on occasion quite alarmed the authorities. As I said, there was a Stanningley stoning incident, but also there was cases of blacklegs, or blacks, as the correspondent to the Home Office referred to them, being attacked, who were being recruited to work in Hallerley and Brooks Mill. As a result of this, several blanket weavers were arrested by the Justices of the Peace at Dewsbury and accused of belonging to illegal combinations and committed to York Castle. And a troop of cavalry was called to escort them from Shaw Cross to York. But the military, according to the report, said after remaining there several hours and finding no demand for their services, they marched back again. And it only required one policeman to escort them in a stagecoach to York without any serious disruption. And it said several thousand persons were collected together and accompanied the coach with music in a kind of triumphal procession. No interruption was thrown in the way to impede their departure. So, again, the dire alarms of some of the members of the manufacturing classes hadn't been realised. Now we're talking about January of 1820, I should hasten to add. I might have jumped a little bit there. We're now into 1820, again, still in the middle of winter. Another correspondent writing about the situation amongst the textile workers used some really alarmist language in a letter to the newspaper. He said, "We are sorry to learn that the principles and practices of the Luddites have, within these few days, been brought into action in our immediate neighbourhood. It seems that on Sunday and Monday last, that's the 5th and 6th of February, several hundreds of men belonging to what is termed the Clothers Union paraded the townships of Batley, Hanging Ean, Doe Green, Hickman, Dyke, etc., creating the greatest alarm. In many instances, they attacked and brutally treated those workmen who were not enrolled in their union. But we have not, as yet, heard of their proceeding to any other acts of violence." And again, there was an alarmist letter from someone calling himself the Observer to the Leeds Intelligencer on the 28th of February. He said, "If he shall question the spirit of mischievous combination, let him say, what could induce an assemblage of the Union from Batley, Littletown, etc., etc., to choose Wednesday, the 16th inst, the day of England's religious solemnity and pious mourning, for a day on which to parade the neighbourhood with drums and music and shouting to the annoyance and insult of every sober and devout feeling and uppermost in the breast of loyal Britons. He's referring, of course, to that day being the funeral of George III, who had passed away. So the lack of respect to the monarchy was causing some alarm and upset amongst members of the local elites there. In fact, one of the bands who had played on that occasion was refused permission to take place a week later when George IV was proclaimed king because it had played at, quote, disloyal and illegal meetings. So even the poor bandsmen were in the middle of the increasing class tensions. So the upshot of it was that a dozen or more members of the clothiers union in the Dewsbury area were eventually arrested and taken to York Castle. And there had been an incident when they were being held in a pub in Dewsbury, had been questioned by the magistrates when a great crowd had gathered outside looking very threatening. But the situation had been diffused by a posse, comitatus being formed of the local respectable citizen, right, who spoke to them and taught them out of any violence, which is a sort of big contrast to some of the military solutions which were being sought elsewhere. So, again, the situation was being exacerbated by people who saw this as a preliminary to some kind of insurrection. And again, so the man called himself Observer looked to Leeds Intelligencer. And it's worth reading in some detail this, because the language is quite lurid and shows the thought processes of the hawks amongst those who supported the authorities. He says, "The clothiers' union, as it is called, deserves more attention than seems to have been paid to it. If this iniquitous combination be not resisted with a different spirit from what has yet been shown, it bid fair to do greater injury to the West Riding in 25 months than all the corn laws, the wool bill, the wars and taxes which have been introduced during the last 25 years. It is a disease to the vitals. In 1812, Luddism skulked in the dark and attacked his victims in masks and in disguise. And when even emboldened to act by day, he still discovered some feeling by hiding in the thicket and retiring from sight. In 1820, Luddism stalks forth in open day, enforces contributions for its support, now assaults the labourer on his way to work, then enters his shop and drives him from his loom. At another time, waylays him, abuses, beats, wounds and disables him. And yet, if fame be not more false than usual, this illegal combination has been expressly sanctioned by the vote of a public vestry meeting in one township, has been encouraged by individuals of some consideration in other places, and has been more than winked at by some who have it in their power to check it. If anyone shall doubt the facts above alluded to, let him inquire at Osset, Mr. Alice's Mill, at Putsey Workhouse, Mr. Varley's Factory at Hills Eden, Dewsbury, Hegmondite, Battle, Wakefield, etc., etc." And this pessimistic analysis was underlined by John Hopkinson, who was a solicitor at Dewsbury, acting on behalf of the merchants and manufacturers. And he wrote a long letter to the Home Office on the 28th of February, outlining the dire situation in the Dewsbury area and the hostility caused by the so-called, he calls them black men, we'd call them blacklegs today. The tensions were growing so much that he hoped that General Byng would send some troops to Dewsbury. To his credit, General Byng refused, saying there were plenty of troops stationed around in Huddersfield and Halifax and Leeds, not many miles distant. So Byng, again, wasn't allowing himself to be stampeded into an overreaction by some representative of the merchants and manufacturers. So when the Dewsbury prisoners ended up at the Lenticisers at York, they all pleaded guilty. The counsel for the prosecution, however, called for a lenient approach to them, and that though they were accused of riotous conduct, the prosecutors, that is their employees, acknowledged that no real harm or damage had been done, and that they hoped that they would be dealt with leniently. And as a result of this, they were discharged on recognisances, and that's it, on bail of £30. And while they're in the dock, all the prisoners behaved with propriety and seemed impressed with the leniency shown towards them. So some, at least, of the manufacturers were prepared to appear conciliatory and weren't seeing this as part of some great insurrection which was taking place. So some of the spinners and weavers who had been involved in the union, in fact, wrote to the Leeds Intelligencer on the 10th of April, regretting their actions and saying that combinations, that is, his trade unions, are something that workers should be wary of. Quote, "For they are alike destructive to the employed as well as the employers." So by the beginning of April, the unrest amongst the weavers in the area had quite died out. And again, this coincides with the aftermath of the insurrection, which took place in Huddersfield on the 1st of April. But another group of workers who were also causing concern to the authorities were the miners. And they had, for even before Peterloo, they'd been organising a union and building up a strike fund. And in November, they took action against some of the coal owners, sending a detailed address of the grievances to the Leeds Mercury. But it ended, interestingly, not in any great radical denunciation of the mine owners or the capitalists, but with a call to religious feeling. It said, "Do unto all men as ye would they should do unto you." And is given the command to remember the poor, and has pronounced a blessing upon such as comply with it, and that a curse is entailed upon the man who withholdeth from the island his wages, or that grindeth the face of the poor. Remember, death is common to all men. The rich and the poor meet together. The Lord is the maker of them both. Our original is dust, and to dust we must return. So there was nothing really threatening in that, apart to the profits of the mine owners. Despite this, some of the authorities did see that there was some hidden threat in the unrest of the coal miners. And again, the response of some of those in authorities was to repress what was called the Colliers Union Society. And in December, John Margison was sent to York Castle for 3 months for enticing his fellow workmen to join an illegal combination. He worked at Floxon Colliery. The colliers throughout the district, from the Leeds area down to Wakefield, were involved at some stage in this unrest. And a massive meeting of colliers was held in Leeds on the 25th of November. And they marched into the town with bands of music. The numbers are disputed. Some say 2,000 to 3,000, some say 5,000. But the appearance of them in military order with bands again caused some alarm amongst sections of the authorities. And in Wakefield, on the day that some of the local miners were arrested and committed to Wakefield jail, there was a big demonstration of their supporters who marched into Wakefield, accompanied by flags and drums, shouting and huzzaing and making the most hideous noise. And that the alarm caused one woman, who was called Mrs. Naylor, to rupture a blood vessel in her head. And it said, according to the Leeds Mercury, In her melancholy death, we see exemplified one of the many evils which the present disturbed state of the times have brought upon us. Now, interestingly, she was the sister-in-law of John Todnaylor, the merchant who was sending reports to the Home Office about the alarming state of the neighbourhood. The biggest colliery in the area, of course, was the one at Middleton, which I've already mentioned, which was also taken up by the dispute. It's interesting that although the miners were pretty militant throughout this period, in November and December, we don't hear of them being directly involved in any of the radical movements. Though no doubt they did, because as I've said, many of them meetings were held on Hunslet Moor, and that was the centre of the colliery district. But we do hear stories of some militant activities by some of the miners. For example, there was a pit rope at one colliery in the neighbourhood of Wakefield was sabotaged. And also there was an attack on Thorpe Oak Colliery in the same area. But the response of the authorities, again, was mainly to pick up a few of the most active men and charge them with forming illegal combinations. So by the end of December, despite statements from the colleagues that they were going out to hold out till the end, many of the disputes had been repressed by the lockout and by the refusal of mine owners to take on anyone who belonged to the miners' union. For example, an advert appeared for Bowling Ironworks, who wanted colliers, and it added to the advert, NB, no workmen need apply who are members of any existing combination or union established for the unlawful purpose of controlling any trade or business as to wages or manner of working or otherwise. So the lockout there was quite emphatic, and it had led to a collapse of the dispute before the beginning of the new year in 1820. So all these industrial disputes, plus the growing radical activity, had led to an atmosphere of foreboding, at least in the minds of some of those in authorities. And the repression of them, all it had done, in effect, was to drive the unrest and discontent underground. And one of the main promoters of this movement locally was Joseph Brayshaw, the Eden schoolmaster, who had been active in the radical movement and who was a delegate between different parts of the country, who were now looking towards some form of insurrection as their only way forward. The exposure of the plot by Thomas Thistlewood in London in February had also ratcheted up apprehension by the authorities. So it was no surprise, really, when the insurrections did take place in Yorkshire on the morning of the 1st of April on the 11th, when the insurrectionists from the Barnsley area marched on Flockton Moor. So the response of the authorities to the unrest and discontent following Peterloo had been basically one of repression. And this was paralleled by the actions being taken against the illegal trade unions. So working class activity had, by this time, practically no legitimate legal means of expression. So it's unsurprising that discontent was forced underground. And this took the form of a planned insurrection which was to take place at the beginning of April 1820. Only the Huddersfield area, parts of Barnsley and parts of Paisley actually rose up in arms, though we know that delegates were going hither and thither between different manufacturing areas And one of the leading delegates was Joseph Brayshaw of Yeadon, who left an account of this period in his memoirs, which were published in the Republican a few years later. So when it happened, the expected explosion was, it was less of an explosion really than the release of a safety valve, as the only means where the so-called lower orders could express their indignation and frustration at the events which had been unleashed by the Peterloo Massacre. And so I'll close on that point without going further into the actual insurrections themselves, which can be read about in Liberty Death as far as Huddersfield goes, and also the national picture is given in Malcolm Chase's book on 1820. So as far as working class activity in this period goes, then Peterloo certainly was a watershed. It was really the beginning of the end of radical activity in the 1819-1820 period. We have to remember that although I've been recounting the story of West Yorkshire, similar movements were going on, particularly in the industrial areas of Lancashire and neighbouring Cheshire, but also in Scotland, in the Paisley area, and in the Midlands. And of course, there was a lot of unrest in London itself during the period after Peterloo and before the 1820 uprising. So this is just one story of one small area. I hope it puts Peterloo in context, and I hope it helps explain to some extent why radical activity declined in our area in the period following Peterloo, and certainly as a result of the disastrous 1820 failed uprising.
This talk has been one of Huddersfield Local History Society's 2020-2021 programme. We are a membership society, and it would be very good if you could come and join us. But if you can't do that, given these difficult COVID times, you can visit our website. There you'll be able to find out what we are, what we do, who we are, and what sort of events and publications we have. Thank you for coming and listening to the talk. We hope to see you again next time. Goodbye for now.